So I am trying to picture Joyce Myers flying down the road, maybe with curlers still in her hair and a bathrobe, trying to get to that house, to the Coleman house, in an hour's time. What would make somebody, you know, she lived about 8 miles away across the Mississippi River, and what would make her so desperate to make this trip right after being notified of the, and who called her? Who told, you know, Christopher Coleman? You know what? Or who, I should say. The only thing I can think of that would send her speeding along the highway during the rush hour would be that she was terrified that this very stupid man that she was probably thinking about this time could bring her empire down and everything she worked for be gone because of this man. That's what I can see as far as a panic. And far from, and instead of giving him condolences, I picture her saying to him, "Don't you dare say a word." And I think that's what happened. Now, going on, when the officer who made the discovery entered the house and made his assessment, he went to feel for a pulse, and he moved the body of the mother, moved her shoulder so as to turn her over so he could feel for a pulse, and the head and neck moved with the shoulder, showing that rigor had already begun, if not was far along. This is not enough time for that amount of rigor to have occurred. That is only 1 hour. He was only gone from the house 1 hour and 15 minutes from time of departure to time of return, or 1.5 hours. He also had videos, video cameras, security cameras throughout his house. Did he remember to turn off the machine and not record what happened inside the house? You see, I think he planned the perfect plan, or what he thought was. And I don't see him as being stupid so much as I think something happened that threw off his plans. Maybe it was the argument at 3 a.m. Maybe it was a discovery of some sort. But I think what he had planned was to be long gone in an airplane with his witness, Joyce Myers, whom no one would question. Just like O.J. Simpson did, you know. The body would not be discovered until he was on a plane and gone. And maybe Christopher Coleman was hoping that the body wouldn't be discovered for days. The bodies wouldn't be discovered for several days. In which case, that makes it even harder for the police to do their work. So was this a mess-up, a screw-up of some sort of his plans? It might have been a pretty good deal if he did pull off getting on a flight, you know, with the reservations and everything all very proper. But who knows? Until we can see those tickets and know the dates and the destination, you know, we're just sort of just making speculation. Let's see if there's any more. I've got some additional links on the side. So they're very, very interesting. My goodness, did that lady have expensive taste? I would not. A minister that needs a marble commode worth $30,000 is not a preacher that has anything to say to me of interest. It just boggles my mind to think how these televangelists get away with, maybe they do get away with murder, who knows. But anyway, for those who aren't familiar with the names, I think I gave that in the first take, there's the usual amount of trouble. Christopher Coleman, the murderer, Sheri Coleman, the wife, Joyce Meyer, the televangelist, Ron Coleman, Pastor Ron Coleman of Grace Church, is the father of Christopher Coleman, and Tara Lintz, and the unfortunate other woman who, just like Amber Fry, was sucked into a horrible murder case that she had no intentions or had no previous knowledge what was going on. That's the trouble, you know. There's so many victims. There's more than the three dead people, you know. Things like this affect so many people. Until next time.